Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Onondaga Community College. I am Daria Willis, the Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, and I welcome you to our fine institution. Before we begin, there are some special guests in the audience that we would like to recognize. Onondaga County Executive Joni Mahoney, Oswego County Legislature Chairman Kevin Gardner, Oswego County Legislature Minority Leader Frank Castiglia, City of Oneida Mayor Leo Matsky, City of Oswego Mayor William Barlow, Commissioner of the Office of Temporary and Disability Assistance Sam Roberts. It is also my pleasure to welcome an already familiar face on our campus, Commissioner Matt Driscoll, former mayor of Syracuse for 8 years and current commissioner of the New York State Department of Transportation. Please help me welcome Commissioner Driscoll to the podium.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Willis, for that kind introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. Great to see you all. It's good to be home. It's good to see some familiar faces as well. So today I'm here to talk about a pressing issue that faces all of New York State, and it's really our kind of tax conundrum, if you will, something that I'm sure is readily known by all of you here in this room. So I have a PowerPoint presentation that I'm going to go through, and then I'll introduce the county executive for a few remarks. And what I'd like to do is try to make this a little more casual because I don't like being behind podiums. Can you all hear me okay? Everybody can hear me in the back? Great. So as I talked about, you know, and the governor has really always been about, since day one when he took office, has been about really tackling, you know, the tough challenges that New York State faces. And certainly we've had our share here in central New York and across the state, as I mentioned at the onset, is taxes. It's something that all of us in our everyday lives face, whether we're purchasing something at the store, or we're buying gasoline, or we're paying our property taxes. Taxes are a fact of life. And it has a big impact on those of us who are middle class, people like myself and many of you, I'm certain. The 2017 budget resolution really does solidly, I believe, frame the discussion on the tax debate. State taxes and, of course, local taxes. And really, what's the driver in between? It's the millionaire's tax. I'm certain many of you have heard about the millionaire's tax. It's a part of the debate that's going on this year. But really, before we begin and we talk about taxes, you really have to talk about spending, right? Because spending equals taxes. And for decades, you know, our state government really spent money quite fast. In fact, spent it faster than the rate of inflation. Didn't matter if you were a Republican or Democrat. You can see here across the board with various governors who were all Republican and Democrat, all of their spending was above the rate of inflation. So they basically were spending more money than they were taking in to run the state. Under Governor Cuomo's leadership of the last 6 years, he's capped that below 2%. So, and you'll hear me talk about the 2% tax cap, but that tax cap, that 2% cap, has been imposed on state agencies as well, like mine. I have to keep my spending below 2%. The governor's done a great job in doing that. And when you do that, when you spend less, then of course, naturally, you can help reduce some of your revenues. And in this case, it's reducing taxes. So here, tax rates are down. You can see, I'll let you read along. Lowest manufacturer's tax rate since 1917. Lowest middle class tax rate since 1947, that's when Jackie Robinson was playing baseball. Lowest corporate tax rate since 1968. And all of that really is good for building out the framework of how we position New York State to grow our economy. Lower taxes with economic incentives and an aggressive pro-business policy, because we need to make sure that not only are we retaining businesses and really keeping those who are here employing people, but we also need to seek out new opportunities for the state as well, and it's been working, I think, convincingly over the last 6 years. The spiral has been changed, the numbers are going up, and you can see here that today we have nearly 8 million new private sector jobs in the state of New York. It's the highest number in the history of the state of New York. Unemployment is down, which is a great obvious number, to go from about 8.4% 6 years ago to about 4.9% this year. And you can see here, it's not in any one region. It's across the board. So that's great numbers as we look forward. But to keep the taxes down, I mentioned keeping state spending below 2%. Like you all control your spending in your lives or in your households. The governor's been adamant about doing that from the state as well. The state also sets a new tax policy going forward. I mentioned the millionaire's tax. It was enacted back in 2009, and it really impacts millionaires of households of 2 million or more. So the proposed, right now it's at 8.2%. If it were to expire, it would go back to about 6.85%, which means that we would be short $3.5 billion. So that revenue stream, as it exists currently, is very important to the state of New York, and quite honestly, it's very important to the middle class. The millionaire tax options, the Senate does not, they favor not renewing the tax. The Assembly wants to raise the millionaire's tax as high as 10%. That's a problem. And the governor's proposal is just to keep it the same. Keep it the same, don't raise it, and don't eliminate it. So you can see here he's also proposing cutting middle tax classes, which would happen if the middle tax class or the millionaire's tax program stays in place. So for incomes of 40 to 150,000, you would see right now you're paying about 6.85%. It would go to 6.45% by next year, and a few years after that, it would flatten out at 5.5%. Same for incomes of $150,000 to $300,000. It's about a $700 average savings for folks. It also proposes a $1 billion increase in education funding and college affordability, and certainly our students who are here today have heard about that, as have others. We in Syracuse know a little bit about that, would say yes, it's a very effective program, and I think statewide it can do great things. So if we allow the state, the millionaire's tax cap to expire, as I mentioned, we'd have a $3.5 billion problem, and that would also mean no increase in the education funding and none of the tax cuts that I just showed you for middle-class families. In central New York, there's about 169 millionaires, and you can see the numbers. I won't describe them to you. I know you can all see the impact versus families versus 169 families. You know, look, life is options, and it's all about the numbers, but the choice is fairly clear. But state taxes really, they're a problem. They are an onerous problem, not only here in central New York, across the state of New York. It's been a historic problem, and it really impedes the middle class as well. But the big problem, can you all still hear me? Yes? Good. The big problem is property taxes. No surprise there. You've all heard about it for many years, and those of us that have a property tax bill, we see it every year. In New York State, it's that. So if you look here, the typical taxpayer in Onondaga County pays about 3.2 times more in property taxes than you pay in your state income tax. In Oswego County, you can see here, it's nearly three times as much as well. So property taxes are a high. It's not about the governor or our county executive or a county executive in any other region of the state. Property taxes are high across the board. FDR pointed it out back in 1932 because he said then, you can read here, that really there's lots of layers of costs that are all factored in and impact our local property tax bill. Over 10,000 local governments across the state, 932 towns, 698 school districts, 62 counties, 864 fire districts, 62 cities, 545 villages, and 6,900 other special districts. So we have a very red state, right? Special districts allow local governments, of course, you set up new districts, whether it's a water district, sewer district, fire district, they're all taxable entities, they cost money. Special districts here, this outlines the number of those districts in the state, and you can see how the cost, frankly, have tripled some from 1940 to about 2000. This is in terms of home value, again, property taxes, we have some of the highest property taxes in the nation. And if this map were to show to the downstate area, they're very high as well. So overall, New York State has a very high property tax burden. 6 years ago, of course, he tackled the problem. I mentioned the 2% property tax cap. It's been very effective. That freeze really has reduced spending increases that were historical of about 10% per year. So overall, across the state of New York, had a cap not been put in place, we would not have saved about $16 billion, including about $801 million right here in New York. So you can see for the average family over those 5 years, nearly $1,300 and about nearly $1,000 in the county of Oswego. With Medicaid, the state's picked up all the growth in that Medicaid mandate since 2011. It's totaling about $3.2 billion in local Medicaid cost across the state. And by the way, as you can read this was something that was enacted in 1965 when Medicaid first came in. It was mandated by the federal government and costs were picked up by the state and then local governments. And sales tax has really gone a long way. That's how sales tax was actually born back in 1964 or 5, was to help pay for that. Onondaga does well in sales tax collections here. But of course, there's more to do. He's proposing, again, a way to lower local property taxes, and this is really about people. This is what this really is. It's really about giving you and me and every other citizen in the state an opportunity to be heard. That's really what this boils down to. To give you an opportunity to go to the ballot box in November and you decide. You can read along here how the process would work. County executives would convene local governments, bring together a plan, the ledge would be involved, and then the public would have an opportunity to say yay or nay. There has to be efficiencies out there. I'm certain there are, and I know that Onondaga County and the city and others have done things, but there certainly is more to do. There's lots of opportunity. You can see here, both in Onondaga and Oswego County, where those opportunities may exist. Duplication clearly is expensive, and it could be considered low-hanging fruit. The Consensus Committee, which no doubt you've all heard about, has released a plan on governor modernization. You can read along here to see what they've identified as some of the fiscal stress that this area faces in particular, tax base, etc. Some of the recommendations you'll see here, again, shared purchasing, training agreements, maintenance, some of the things that were just pointed out on the screen earlier with opportunities with snow and ice perhaps, or summer maintenance with parks and recs. There's lots of opportunity out there. But the governor's shared service proposal really is different. And as I mentioned, it really gives the shared services proposals here. It really comes down to giving people an opportunity to be heard. It's really an opportunity for the public to determine once and for all whether or not they want to see more efficiencies, some consolidations, and others. So his plan is very distinct from the consensus plan. The current situation is not good business. Syracuse, the city, has some challenges. It continues to slide, and so does the region. This is just an example of some of the numbers for the city of Syracuse. And then again, it's really not just about the city of Syracuse. If you look at our state's major urban centers, particularly across the Empire Highway, as you see here, there's stress levels. And so you'll see where state funding really makes up, in most cases, the lion's share of local budgets. It's not sustainable. Frankly, we need a new business model. And that's why your voice is important. So if local government, now this is the myth you've been hearing, if local government doesn't participate, the state's not gonna, they're gonna withhold the money, you're not gonna get any money. It's not true. It's not true, it's totally false. It's the opposite, actually. If you provide and savings are found, the governor's gonna put more money in and match those savings with additional resources. So he's really talking about doing things very differently. He's been doing that all along. Our state, like most states, I talk to people all the time because that's what I do about infrastructure, both in terms of underground infrastructure and of course road and bridges. We live in an old state. Our infrastructure is old, it's challenged. You've read many times about the broken water pipes or the aged bridge, you've seen all that. But the makeup, the very design of our government is dated as well. So we do need to think long and hard about how we modernize the structure of our local governments. FDR, he said a lot, and he said more here, as you can see, about how you devise really and change a system back then that was devised 200 years previous to that. So again, the economy continues to change. There's no doubt about it. We need a new business model. And if we think about how we operate, it's how I've always done. I tried to do that in the city, try to have more of an entrepreneurial spirit, if you will, and think of it in business terms on how we operate. And that's the modernization that we need to do as well. And so it's really time to innovate and recreate. It's something that the governor's been doing all along, definitely tackling tough challenges each and every day. Change is hard, and they will fear the change. And I always say, the only change people like is the change that's in their pocket. But we need to think differently, because it is a different world. It's a different economy. And particularly for our young people here, what do we want the world to be when you're the next leaders? So we want to create that base that is a successful, sustainable base for all of us so that we have jobs, so that our children can be here and our grandchildren and have an opportunity to prosper. You know, he's done some pretty miraculous things here with the minimum wage, supporting working families, marriage equality, somewhat risky things, I suppose people would argue. State budgets on time, very important for local government when you're doing your budget planning. Keeping that spending under 2%, he is dogging on that. I can tell you that firsthand. Paid Family Leave Act. Again, the property tax cap will remain again this year. And then, of course, new projects that we're doing, the Tappan Zee Bridge, which is rising up out of the waters of the Hudson River. It's a really a miraculous sight to see. And some other things here locally, the state fairgrounds, I'm certain many of you have heard about that. Hancock International is going to be recreated. You've got the Hotel Syracuse that's just come back online. Onondaga Lake Amphitheater, which is drawing people to the region, and I understand a large number of those visitors are from outside Onondaga County. We want them to bring their money here. So that's a great thing, and that's been a successful project. So listen, all the arrows are up. We are moving in the right direction, but it's not easy. It's tough work. Your voices are very important, and that's the point that the governor is making by let's keep it going. Your voices are important in this process. So I want to thank you for giving me just a few minutes to kind of run through this.
Hello, it's nice to see everybody here. I appreciate the opportunity to talk. Thank you very much, Commissioner, Mayor Driscoll, for that presentation. And welcome to the members of the surrounding counties. Welcome to Onondaga County. Thank you very much for being here. I can't hear. It's a combination of a cold and the Duke game last night. I was inside the Carrier Dome, so my voice feels funny to me, so I apologize in advance. But I appreciate the opportunity to talk a little bit about how things are from the perspective of Onondaga County, and I'm sure that it is a perspective that is shared by my colleagues in the surrounding counties. Onondaga County has done a lot of sharing of services with other municipalities. The prime example for us is purchasing. Since I've become county executive, Onondaga County has taken on the job of purchasing for the city of Syracuse, for the city school district, for a lot of the municipalities, and even now Otsego County, one of our neighboring counties. Onondaga County is doing the purchasing. And I know you all have similar stories in other counties and in the towns and in the villages where people have come together and we have done things that we are proud of that have delivered services better and less expensively. And that's what the whole point of what the proposal is, as I see it, with the governor, is a tool in our toolbox to try to keep that momentum going. And I want to draw, I just want to talk about a couple of the things that I hear. I hear state mandates are the problem. So we're not the problem. Local government's not the problem. And I will agree that state mandates are very expensive, but it's been decades in the making. Commissioner Driscoll just showed the level of state spending going back several governors. We are not going to undo in 1 year any of the issues that we've created over decades in New York State. But I will tell you that in the current Onondaga County budget, The cost of our state mandates is less than it was a few years ago. The Medicaid hard cap has helped tremendously, as have other efforts that the state has made to help reduce state mandates. So they are, you know, they are doing what some of probably what they can do on the state level to reduce those mandates. But there's no reason that that in and of itself should prevent us from trying to do our part on the local level. The governor is offering us a tool to do that. He's making it possible for us to get directly to people to ask them for their input. And I've been disappointed, but I suppose it illustrates the problem. In the last couple weeks, I've heard a lot of people, including local elected officials, talk about this as a heavy hammer coming down from the state forcing us to do something. It is not true. And I would give a pass to regular citizens who are repeating that because I know they're hearing it from all over the place. But for our local elected officials, I would say either one, you're not doing your homework, because if you read the state budget, it's not what it says, or two, there's a purposeful mischaracterization of what it is. And out of respect for the people who live here in this community, this region, we have an obligation to give people accurate facts and ask them to participate in an honest, sincere conversation. The governor is not threatening aid to localities if we don't act. That's not true. The city of Syracuse's state funding is not on the line based on whether we go forward with a referendum. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't or we should. It's just a matter of fact that what the governor is saying is if you go forward with a referendum that results in savings, the state will match those savings dollar for dollar. It's a carrot. It's not a hammer. And if you hear it characterized as a hammer, I would ask you to do your part to try to get that conversation turned back around to what is more accurate. And I would also ask, why is there so much energy being expended by people that are trying to prevent a referendum? The governor is saying, and this is where I think all of this mischaracterization is illustrating why we need something like this. The governor is saying, take it to the people. The conversation about consolidation and shared services has gone on in Onondaga County and probably in your counties for decades. Take it to the people. Here in Onondaga County, we're lucky because we have Consensus, which is a group of citizens that came together, spent 3 years listening to the public, gathering data from villages, towns, Onondaga County, the city of Syracuse, and have given us a roadmap. And a lot of energy is being expended in preventing the public from voting on that. And I really think people should stop and ask themselves why all the effort into preventing citizens from having a say in what they want their government to look like. It illustrates that this tool can be very valuable. What it's doing is giving me as county executive and the other county leaders an opportunity to bring something to the people. And I, for one, have a lot of faith in the people who live in the region to make a good decision. So I do not ever stand in the way of a public referendum on what our government is gonna look like. And I'm ready to do my part. I think my agenda's clear. I'm in my 10th year. I'm trying to make this community the kind of place that the next generation can thrive in. I've said it before, my husband and I are raising 4 boys. One of them turned 20 today. I would like them to have an opportunity here in Central New York. And I'm ready, willing, able to do my part with a great staff. I would like to sit down with the villages, the towns, take advantage of this new tool, sit with the city of Syracuse, identify the things we agree on, do not let the perfect be the enemy of the good, and take a step in the right direction that makes it more likely that the young people here in our audience will have an option of thriving in Central New York. That is a very simple request. It's a profound change, and it's empowering the people who live here to participate in what they want in their local government for years to come. I'm very grateful that the state has taken this on, and I'm asking all of you to do your part to ensure that you have a voice in this process. Your voice will come in a referendum. And for the people that are trying very hard to prevent you from exercising that voice, I would put some thought into why that might be and why we even need a tool to get around the local elected officials in some instances. So thank you all for your attention. Thank you to OCC for hosting us and Commissioner Driscoll for laying that out. And it's up to you. As Commissioner Driscoll said, it's your opportunity. This is the first time in my experience as a Central New Yorker that I have the opportunity to go into a voting booth and vote on what I want my government to look like. And I, for one, don't want anybody to prevent me from doing that. So please join me in participating in what I think is going to be a great civic discussion. Thank you all very much for coming.